This is a compelling story of William G. Kirchhoff, which is told through many interesting and outstanding photos collected since 1998. The story is in four parts. It is a wonderment that one person could have accomplished all to the finish line, but the fact that he never failed is an outstanding fact which proves he had integrity, probity, and reliability. His word was his bond. Today, it is hard for us to understand, for a handshake was in place of all the legal documents we have today. This gentleman's agreement defined the business milieu of William Kirchhoff. Let's move on into the Kirchhoff's incredible accomplishments, projects which set the course for the growth of California for decades, yet so innocently and so honestly completed based on a man's word of honor. It was for his integrity, probity, and reliability that the New York financial houses and banks advanced funds, approved bond issues, and otherwise endorsed Mr. Kirchhoff's projects before even the initial plans for the project were drafted. This commemorative covers some of the many accomplishments of William G. Kirchhoff. The Upland Community Foundation commissioned Art Mortimer to create this mural within the grounds of the San Antonio Park at the trolley waiting station, as shown in the photo of the mural. Mr. Kirchhoff purchased the Ontario and San Antonio Railroad Company and expanded the service from Ontario and Upland to Claremont and Pomona before selling the larger company to the Pacific Electric Company. In the center of the mural, you will see the 1907 trolley at the San Antonio Park's waiting station. This was the northwestern terminus of the railroad. Here, the Electric Railroad created a park setting and built this granite fieldstone station for the convenience of the passengers waiting for the next trolley or a motor stage. The motor stage on designated days would take the riders up the winding road to Camp Baldy. During the summer, the trolley ride was a favorite, and especially to the park. The cool ride, because of the movement of the trolley, was a relaxing way to spend a hot weekend. The last scheduled trolley from Ontario to the park was at 10 p.m. Many took just the ride up, then down to the valley floor. The Upland Community Foundation restored the waiting station. William G. Kirchhoff was born on March 30, 1856, at Terre Haute, Indiana, the son of George W. B. Kirchhoff and Philippine Newart Kirchhoff. William G. spent his early boyhood days out of doors as much as he could, for he loved fishing and hunting. As Henry W. O'Melveny wrote, "The love of the outdoors was born within him, and this inborn love was encouraged and nurtured and increased by the environment surrounding him, so that it remained with him all his life." After the end of the Prussian-Austrian War in 1866, George Kirchhoff and his brother-in-law decided to take their families and go back to Germany. Here, William attended the gymnasium at Lingen, where his father was educated. In a very few years, the two families realized that they preferred the U.S. and returned to Terre Haute. In 1875, William's cousin, George Reisman, had planned a trip to California, and William joined him. The transcontinental trip by rail had glamour and adventure. When they arrived in the San Joaquin, it was a vast, unoccupied plain with only a few towns and villages. Roads were few and unimproved. Transportation was by stagecoach. The young men, as vagabonds, camped in the Sierras, Yosemite Valley, and went on to the Big Trees area on the Calaveras River. Their wanderings took them through meadows with abundant wildflowers, running streams, granite masses, and domes of Yosemite, the moonlight and reflections on the river, and all this made a deep imprint. He never lost his love for the mountains. In 1877, through William's persuasion, his father visited California with his daughter Augusta. Once here, they were so favorably impressed, they all moved to California. Jumping ahead, though relative to Yosemite Valley, in 1889, Yosemite Park was under the ownership and care of the state of California. The park was managed by a commission of five members. William was appointed by Governor Budd in 1898 and reappointed in December 1902 by Governor Gage. He served until March 1905, when the area was re-granted to the U.S. government. This was the only public office he ever held, for his multi-businesses required his full attention, as you will clearly witness. William Kirchhoff's entrance into business was by purchasing an interest in the J.G. Jackson Lumber Company on the corner of 1st and Alameda Streets. At the age of 23, this was a natural course, for he loved the outdoors and the smell of pine, cedar, and other woods connected him to the mountains. Los Angeles and the surrounding area had a population at that time of about 10,000. Mr. Kuzner was the manager of the Los Angeles Yard, which was part of a San Francisco lumber company. After some correspondence back and forth, the price was $7,500 for a quarter of the company. Mr. Kirchhoff asked Mr. Kuzner, "Where do you come in?" He went on to say that he was retiring. William quickly said, "Oh no, I know nothing about the business, and if you do not stay, the deal is off." Mr. Kuzner then purchased also a quarter interest, and on April 1, 1879, the firm became Jackson, Kirchhoff & Kuzner. On November 13, 1883, Mr. Kirchhoff was married to Miss Louise Ashman at Terre Haute, Indiana. The couple came to Los Angeles. As Henry W. O'Melveny wrote, "This was truly one of those marriages made in heaven." When William's father arrived, he purchased a quarter from the Jackson interest, and William took the remaining quarter interest. They incorporated December 17, 1883. Mr. Kirchhoff was president, and Mr. Kuzner was vice president. The corporation purchased Bosque's Island in San Pedro for their wharves. So at 27, William was married and owned one half of the lumber company, with his father owning a quarter and Mr. Kuzner owning the remaining quarter. During the boom of 1887, Kirchhoff Kuzner Milling and Lumber witnessed delays in getting lumber from their sawmill in Gardner, Oregon, so they commissioned their own ocean freighter, Pasadena. An idea proposed to them by Union Oil was to burn bunker fuel instead of coal, a revolutionary change from the past. The idea was never heard of, burning oil at sea. Oil burns on water. When they told the shipbuilder of their plan, the shipbuilder refused. They would not build it, for they felt responsible for the lives of the crew. However, they finally went ahead. The big change was the placement of the tanks on the deck, for the coal compartment would have been too close to the boilers. From the start, the change from coal to oil was a great success. No longer was it necessary to have two men shoveling coal day and night, for the same could be accomplished by just turning a valve. Then a shocker. A small ferry boat blew up due to oil, resulting in the killing and drowning of many people. As it turned out, the oil tank was intact after lifting the ferry. The blast was due to a defective boiler. Kirchhoff had his two brothers-in-law as officers. One served as secretary and the other was treasurer. The wholesale side of the business on the wharves continued well after the passing of Louise. They had lumber yards in Azusa, Burbank, Glendora, La Monda, Los Angeles, Pasadena, Pomona, including yards in Imperial Valley, and the wholesale yard was at the wharves in San Pedro. This photo shows Los Angeles Plaza, and in the background, the main office of Kirchhoff Kuzner Mill and Lumber Company. This photo shows the celebration of the first rail service to Pasadena on September 21, 1885. Note the lumber company in the background and the two children. Of the lumber firms that were in business from 1883 to 1890, not one existed except for Kirchhoff Kuzner Milling and Lumber. Also, it is worthy to note that up until the mid-20s, primarily all of the citrus packing houses were wood-sided, and the same could be said for many commercial buildings. The craftsman or Victorian styles dominated the construction of new homes until the mid-20s, and this design called for wood or shingle siding. The use of stucco for exteriors followed this trend to imitate the Spanish or the Venetian styles. Also, prior to the 1890s, cement had to be imported from England. California Portland Cement Company was started in the 1890s after discovering Slover Mountain in Colton. In 1891, the life work of William G. Kirchhoff made an abrupt change. He observed the potential power of water, which generated electricity, and was consumed several feet away. The first commercial use of the San Gabriel River water was to manufacture ice. The project was initiated by Metcalf Dodsworth. His idea was that ice could be manufactured by the power of water at a cost that would produce a handsome profit. He interested William Kirchhoff in this project. The water of the San Gabriel River, running in a ditch belonging to one of the irrigation companies, crossed a gulch in a flume that had a 60-foot drop, and after the drop could still continue in the irrigation ditch. The place was at Azusa and the Santa Fe tracks. The Kirchhoff Kuzner Company purchased about 15 acres for $15,150 in gold coins and started the Azusa Ice and Cold Storage Company on January 12, 1891, with the financial help of additional investors, which included Messrs. M. G. Eshman, Abe Haas, Casper Cohn, and Henry O'Melveny. The power of water changed the direction of the life of William G. Kirchhoff. Within a year from opening the ice plant, the Santa Fe system was buying daily up to 100 tons of ice, primarily to be used in the shipping of citrus. An addition was made to the plant in 1894 and again in 1903 when they purchased a 35-ton refrigerator machine. This was in addition to their existing three 16-ton machines. The plant was an instant success and very profitable. The Santa Fe system had agreed to purchase all surplus ice before the plant was even built. This ice plant, with its water power, was the forerunner of the vast hydroelectric system which Mr. Kirchhoff had the vision to assemble. Fire destroyed the plant in 1922. Now we realize we are jumping way ahead of our developing timeline, though we wanted to illustrate the growing demand for energy, ice, and other commodities as a result of the emerging, thriving California citrus industry. This was 1905, and The Place, Azusa Ice and Cold Storage Company. Note the three additions to the building. Based on the year, the Azusa location, and the structural changes, the writer is suggesting this exterior site to be the Azusa Ice and Cold Storage Company. Pictured left to right were Mr. Pate, AT&SF, J.G. McKinney, Los Angeles Ice and Cold Storage Company, B.A. Woodford, manager of the Azusa Covina Fruit Exchange and general manager of the California Fruit Growers Exchange, G.H. Powell, pomologist, USDA, and Walter Barnwell, assistant freight agent for the AT&SF Railway. Their visit was to learn the efficiencies by seeing firsthand the energy or power of water employed in making ice. They realized the need of ice, though the importance or prominence was the economical means by which it was produced. At this moment in time, we need to take a detour or a spur to also cover a very important event which solidified Mr. Kirchhoff's quest to employ the power of water. Before you are photos of Dr. Cyrus G. Baldwin, Almerian William Decker, and George Westinghouse. Dr. Baldwin had the good providence or good fortune in having an exemplary friend, Almerian William Decker, who had a sharp interest in electricity and engineering. The year was 1891. Dr. Cyrus Baldwin, the first president of Pomona College, enjoyed the outdoors and highly valued the time spent in the San Antonio Canyon. He envisioned a dream, looking down from high up in the steep ravine, of lighting at night the valley floor below, from the power of the swift-flowing creek. Immediately after hearing of Cyrus's interest, Decker formulated a system proposal of 10,000 volts with three-phase alternating current. When George Westinghouse heard of the aforementioned plan, he scoffed at the entire project. Though later, hearing that two of his respected peers thought the system had merit, Westinghouse decided to build the plant. The only exception was the three-phase pure foolishness. This had to be omitted. The bird's-eye view of the tunnel can be seen as designed by Dr. Baldwin. This photo is proof of Dr. Baldwin's zealous salesmanship. He told others, and his earnest enthusiasm compelled more to join with him in buying into his plan of building a hydroelectric plant in the San Antonio Creek. Further, from the revenue earned from the sale of electricity, he could endow his young Congregational College. He sold stock to raise the funding of this tunnel, which extended about 1,300 feet to the other side of the hill, and the tunnel took a significant duration to complete. A pipeline brought down the water under high pressure, which energized the plant. Some in the photo can be identified as Dr. Baldwin in a dark suit on the left, J. Albert Dole, president, standing in front of the tunnel, and A. W. Burt, general manager, with transit. One can view from Dr. Baldwin's photo the high-pressure water line leading from the tunnel to the San Antonio Light and Power Company's hydroelectric plant. The plant is hidden due to the elevation change of the creek bed. One can also plainly see the debris spilled out from digging the tunnel. In the left foreground, you can catch a glimpse of the house for the caretaker. As mentioned in an Edison Company publication by William A. Myers, Iron Men and Copper Wires, Dr. Baldwin's success through his brilliant engineer Almerian William Decker, establishing a world's record for commercial long-distance electric transmission. On November 28, 1892, the plant was energized and 10,000 volts of alternating current flowed 14 miles to Pomona. Again on December 31, 1892, a line of 29 miles was energized and placed in service to San Bernardino, illuminating the Times Index building. As stated, the distance was a world record, though what was also unique was the use of a higher voltage alternating current system with the concept of step up and then step down transformation of current at the destination. Decker's rule of thumb was that he needed 1,000 volts of pressure to reach a mile in distance. With this development, the formulation had finally been set, which could enable electric service to be extended to any outlying customer. The Pomona accomplishments of Dr. Cyrus G. Baldwin and engineer Almerian W. Decker caught the attention of the world. The oil-filled transformers became standard in the industry, though the paramount principle was the unique step-up, step-down transformation for long-distance transmission of electricity. All were quantum advancements. Also from this, Westinghouse's name became known. Let's go inside. Here we view a big flywheel driving one dynamo. Please note the back wall. Today we take concrete as a prevalent common material. But then the source was England. It was shipped in barrels to this site. Another photo of Dr. Baldwin's, showing the interior of the plant including the switchboard and the bank of transformers, which increased the voltage output of the two generators, shown on the right. This photo shows the bank of Dr. Baldwin's history-making transformers through the engineering of Almerian W. Decker. A true accomplishment, and the basic principle is approximately the same today. The rainfall statistics gives proof of the severity of the drought as illustrated for upland. To compensate for the decrease in surface water flowing through the creek, this small pioneer company installed in Pomona, in the 300 block of North Gibbs, a steam plant to produce more electricity, incurring more expense. Then, the knockout punch. A blizzard struck and caved in the roof of their hydroelectric plant. Finally, the SALNP just could not match the forces of nature. Dr. Baldwin and his investors lost their company. The year was 1899, and it would appear to the contentious that SALNP was a failure. Its failure was due to the fickle and unpredictable weather. Yes, in looking back, they had more than their share of reversals, though they were forerunners. This company was the first to establish the commercial feasibility of long-distance, high-voltage transmission of alternating current through the use of transformers. Probably its highest consideration to this forerunner company was that it established the primary foundation and principles of the grid system used worldwide by the electrical utility industry. No one cannot conclude that Dr. Baldwin and his investors were unrealistic individuals. They were ahead of the times. To continue our journey on this detour regarding the work of Dr. Baldwin, his progress was closely watched by William Kirchhoff and a group from Redlands. Harry H. Sinclair in 1892 organized Redlands Electric Light and Power Company to power the city with streetlights and also power the emerging citrus packers. Shown is their office staff in front of their office. They planned to build a hydroelectric plant on Mill Creek. Impressed with the inventiveness of Almerian Decker through his work on the San Antonio Light and Power Company, they engaged him to design their plant. The specifications were identical to what he had done for Dr. Baldwin, including also three phase. Before you is the Mill Creek Hydroelectric Plant, which was built during the later part of 1892. The funding for the most part came from Henry Fisher, a Pittsburgh capitalist. A division dam was constructed about 2 miles above the powerhouse, and a 30-inch steel pipe was installed through a tunnel, which was said to be 7,250 feet long. Now we are in the history-making Mill Creek Hydroelectric Plant. The front two generators made history on September 7, 1893, generating three-phase alternating current. The rear generator was brought in during 1898 to generate power from steam. The belt powered the generator from a steam engine placed outside. The drought caused this disruption. This is the switchboard for Mill Creek's hydroelectric plant. Union Ice Company built a new ice plant referred to as Union Ice No. 2 near Crafton. This location was strategic in that it could serve both Southern Pacific and the Santa Fe systems within the citrus-growing regions of San Bernardino and Riverside counties. This huge 200-horsepower electric motor before you energized the new ice plant, and the three-phase electric power was supplied by the Mill Creek Hydroelectric Plant. Union Ice found it cheaper to make the ice in Crafton because of its low cost of energy, and ship the ice to the various users than to make the ice closer to their buyers in Los Angeles. What also made this situation special was that some claim this was the first recorded commercial buyer of hydroelectric power in the U.S. Now let's put this detour in perspective. Within approximately 9 months after Dr. Baldwin's success in long-distance transmission of electricity through the use of transformers, the Mill Creek plant on September 7, 1893, introduced three-phase alternating current as specified by Almerian W. Decker through the newly formed General Electric Company. Mr. Decker died on August 3, 1893, and never observed this historic moment in time. From his accomplished skills in engineering, as stated by William A. Myers in his book, Iron Men and Copper Wires, this became the type of electricity generated virtually everywhere. All of these contributions originated from California's inland empire. From a practical position with the introduction of electricity, this eliminated the job of stocking kerosene to fill each lamp and daily cleaning every lantern's glass lens. With the occurrence of electricity, the light bulbs providing lighting to California's second largest industry, the citrus industry. The two men seated at the top left with their backs to the camera were providing power to the two sizing machines through 2-foot treadles. At that time, the foot treadle was universal for most citrus packing houses. This is an outstanding photo of Upland Citrus Association circa 1905. The citrus industry located in and around Redlands had the opportunity of having electric arc lighting and electric motors to power their conveyor belts due to their location of being in the area of the Mill Creek Hydroelectric Plant. This photo shows the interior of Redlands Orange Producers Packing House, an early client of Mill Creek's three-phase electricity. Now the California citrus industry had the power and the means to modernize and grow. Order your copy by visiting the website www.citrusroots.com. The next chapter, so to speak, or part two, will cover the formation of the Pacific Light and Power Company. This company primarily developed and generated cheap electricity through hydropower to energize Henry Huntington's Pacific Electric Railway system. The birthplace was on the banks of the San Gabriel River, and the name was San Gabriel Electric Company. In 1902, this company was merged into the new Pacific Light and Power Company, and William Kirchhoff's other hydroelectric plants followed over time. The formation of this company continued to grow in keeping with the electrical demand. What William did not know was the years he would consume in negotiating with the Committee of Nine, each representing an interest which was entitled to the water of the river. Nine sets of interests, each defending his perceived rights. At the onset on September 15, 1892, the committee was in complete rejection of all overtures. They would not allow any water diverted under any circumstances. What an attorney representing one of the nine would conjure up, another did, and the years ran by. The final signatures to the contract were obtained about March 5, 1898, almost 6 years spent in negotiations. Then there was another group outside of the Committee of Nine. They announced their opposition and threatened litigation. They were satisfied in 1897 when given power at a reduced rate to operate a pumping plant on their land. In retrospect, this was a story of trials and tribulations, a story of fighting against odds. As Henry O'Melveny remembered, this illustrated Mr. Kirchhoff's strong tenacity in never yielding to difficulties. He just steadily continued in pursuing his course to final achievement. On June 29, 1898, the titles were established, the transmission line in place, and the receiving station in Los Angeles finished and ready to receive the current. As stated by Mr. O'Melveny, one can imagine the feelings of Mr. Kirchhoff as he stood in the receiving station in Los Angeles awaiting the fixed minute when the water would be applied to the generating wheels in San Gabriel Canyon. The hopes, the fears, the perplexities, and the labor of 7 years were crystallized in that second of time. It is harder to imagine the depth of satisfaction and happiness that followed when the instruments in Los Angeles registered that the project was successful and that the miracle had been accomplished. The slow drifting water of the San Gabriel had been lifted to the mountainside, and by applying the power generated by its gravity to the generating wheels of the plant, that power had been transformed into subtle electricity, which, winging its way to Los Angeles, was again transformed into the power that propelled the streetcars of Los Angeles. It was a glorious moment in his life. Again, inside the plant, with its 5 two-phase AC 300 kilowatt generators. One views the serenity of the water spilling over into the channel after it has expended its great power in turning the generators to produce electricity. In 1896, Alan Balch, an electrical engineer, had joined Mr. Kirchhoff to assist in utilizing the power from water under pressure. From their dam in the San Gabriel Canyon, the water was channeled for approximately 7 miles with a drop of 400 feet to the powerhouse. Also, you will recognize the name of Balch relative to Scripps College. This early photo shows the high pressure line, boarding house quarters, and the water being returned to the river channel. Remembering the arguments of the Committee of Nine, there was far more water returned because of steel pipes than if the water was to run down the gravel channel subject to percolation and evaporation. Today, this plant is still generating electricity for the city of Pasadena. This is a bird's eye view of the San Gabriel Electric Company in 1911, with its high pressure lines leading to the hydroelectric plant. Mr. Kirchhoff consolidated this company under one name, Pacific Lighting and Power Corporation. San Gabriel Electric Company was the beginning of the prominent name, Pacific Light and Power Corporation. On September 18, 1900, the San Gabriel Electric Company agreed to purchase all of the property rights and liabilities of San Antonio Light and Power Company. By February 14, 1901, William Kirchhoff's new Sierra Power Plant was in operation. It was located about 2,000 feet below the old SAL&P site and utilized the most direct path for the new 24-inch high-pressure pipeline installed from the SAL&P's tunnel. This photo shows Baldwin's abandoned historic San Antonio Light and Power Company's plant. The remains were washed away during the flood of 1938. This is William Kirchhoff's new Sierra Power Company's plant on the San Antonio Creek. Another view of the Sierra plant, showing the two covered Pelton wheels and the trail race. By 1906, this plant was capitalized at $2 million. The switchboard, as it appeared in May 1911 at the Sierra plant. Henry E. Huntington, having purchased the street railroad system in Los Angeles, perceived the advantage of cheap hydroelectric power for his enterprise and joined in with Kirchhoff's investors. The Pacific Light and Power Company was formed, and in 1910, it was incorporated. Now, returning back to Mr. Kirchhoff's lumber business, he was no stranger to Mr. Huntington, for the two had a friendly business transaction when Kirchhoff was president and manager of the San Gabriel Valley Rapid Transit Railroad, which connected to Los Angeles, Pasadena, and Monrovia. They sold the rail carrier to Southern Pacific Railroad Company. Mr. Kirchhoff had entered into the rail business because of his lumber enterprise. He realized quickly the handicaps of a small, independent railroad company and persuaded his associates to sell. A look inside of the Sierra Powerhouse. Starting in 1913 through 1917, all hydroelectric plants were consolidated into Pacific Light and Power Corporation. The Mentone Power Company on Mill Creek was put into operation in September of 1904 and transmitted two 15,000-volt circuits tying into the Upland substation. In the photo, one can follow the high-pressure penstocks leading downhill to the powerhouse. Today, this plant is no longer active. The Pedley Powerhouse was a part of Pacific Light and Power Company from 1906 to 1914 and located on the Santa Ana River. William E. Pedley, an English-trained civil engineer, organized the Riverside Power Company in 1901. Mr. Kirchhoff acquired this small company through a bankruptcy. Today, it is no longer active. This plant is in a picturesque setting far from civilization. Another very bitter contest over diverting water took place between Kern County Land Company and Miller & Lux. They waited until the plant was next to being completed before filing a permanent injunction restraining the water from being diverted into a pipeline, which would have saved water from evaporation and percolation as compared to the riverbed. On December 29, 1904, a consent decree was issued and the generators were thrown into action. Today, this plant has been modernized and is still operating. The remoteness and the steep grade required that all material to be transported to the site had to be by 10 teams of slow-moving mules. At that time, motor vehicles could not make the steep incline. Water from the Kern River was diverted and carried by canal and a flume to the powerhouse. This was by far the largest undertaking to date by Kirchhoff and generated 10,000 kilowatts, which traveled 127 miles to Los Angeles at 55,000 volts. Another pioneering achievement of Mr. Kirchhoff. Used to supplement cheap hydroelectric power. William Kirchhoff was the founder and president of Pacific Light and Power Company. The steam plant is in the background. Note the way people dressed to go to the beach. From the very beginning, and in 1912, this facility was cited as being the most efficient plant in the U.S. Even though this plant was the most efficient compared to other steam plant operations, it was more expensive than hydroelectric power. Kirchhoff's steam plant cost 4 cents a kilowatt hour to produce, while hydroelectric power cost under 0.1 cents per kilowatt hour. Clearly, hydroelectric was the preferred choice, and this drove Kirchhoff et al. To focus on the Big Creek project. Running at full capacity on a cold morning, the exhaust system made for a spectacular sight. For 5 additional years, John Eastwood waited on a retainer, encouraged by knowing that Southern California was growing at an accelerating rate. Further, the demand for electricity would also be compounding. Early in 1910, Mr. Huntington came to the same mindset as Mr. Kirchhoff to commence the Big Creek project. Unfortunately, Mr. Huntington chose not to hire Mr. Eastwood, the man who designed and engineered the overall entire concept and employed Stone & Webster Engineering Corporation. Plant number one was finished in 1913. The Big Creek San Joaquin River Hydroelectric Project was destined to be the largest hydroelectric project in the nation and was to be financed entirely by private capital. The two photos show Kirchhoff's Big Creek Powerhouse No. 1, which was completed in 1913. Both photos show the granite dome, Kirchhoff Dome, honoring William G. Kirchhoff. In the photo to the left, one can view the San Joaquin and Eastern Railroad's rail bus number 501 heading down to Auberry. John S. Eastwood was educated in Minnesota as an engineer and moved to Fresno. In 1894, this slow-speaking Lincoln-esque engineer and surveyor wandered over the uncharted ranges towering above his new home. He filed water rights and took notes, calculating the flow of streams and elevations, which he used to draft a very vast, detailed system of reservoirs and tunnels regarding the San Joaquin River region. He envisioned many powerhouses in a chain, producing thousands of kilowatts on its descending fall of over 5,000 feet. In 1902, from the light provided from a campfire, he wrote William Kirchhoff, "It gives me great pleasure to inform you that I have completed the survey for a tunnel line to the junction of Pittman and Big Creek, and I can place before you the most remarkable power project yet presented." Messrs. Kirchhoff and Alan Balch made an agreement with him to study his recommendations. It should also be noted that some engineers have stated that this project was the largest construction project in the world, and whose complexities were to rival that of the Panama Canal. Eastwood also developed a new type of reinforced concrete multiple arch dam, a highly economical design that minimized the amount of material required, which reduced transportation costs. Just a point of information, Eastwood also designed the Bear Valley Mutual Water Company's dam, or better known as the Big Bear Dam, in the San Bernardino Mountains. It has been estimated that more than 400,000 tons of machinery and supplies were hauled to the Big Creek area during the short lifetime of the San Joaquin and Eastern Railroad. The latter fulfilled the transportation needs of the Big Creek project and was abandoned in 1933. This exceptional 1916 photo illustrates another mode of transportation, the use of motor vehicles. These Mack Bulldog trucks are shown on the Kaiser Pass Road headed for the area of Florence Lake, and could only be routed during the summer months. Motor vehicles and road building were still in their development stages, even though this photo was taken after the Kirchhoff-Huntington separation. The Big Creek project was originally masterminded by engineer John Eastwood. The plan called for the construction of three massive concrete dams, each over 100 feet in height, to form reservoirs or lakes. From the lakes, water would flow through a short tunnel and drop more than 2,100 feet in a steel penstock pipeline to Powerhouse No. 1. A division dam below that plant would guide the water into a second tunnel and penstock with a near 1,900 feet vertical drop to Powerhouse No. 2. This photo shows Powerhouse No. 2 with an addition, which is the shorter building to the left. Shaver Lake is below and not in this photo. Florence Lake Dam. The dam was designed by Mr. Eastwood and was one of the three reservoirs as mentioned above. All were commenced during Kirchhoff's presidency of Pacific Light and Power Corporation. It was June of 1913, and we are on the open plains of the San Joaquin Valley, running the 150,000-volt power lines from the Pacific Light and Power Corporation's Eagle Rock substation outside of Los Angeles to the Big Creek Powerhouse No. 1, a distance of 243 miles. The high-pressure 150,000-volt power used by the Big Creek lines required all new redesigned insulators, transformers, circuit breakers, and switch gear. When completed, this will be the longest distance, highest voltage lines in the world. By the first few days of November 1913, this record-setting power line had been completed, though it remained to be tested. This would have been a Herculean job anytime, though especially with the help of mules. We need to also focus our attention on the size of this project and the financial agreement made between parties, who expected its completion based on good faith, the innocence of a handshake. All of what you have viewed to this point was all held together by the threads of truth, honesty, and respect. These same qualities held these early partnerships and deals together through to completion. The accomplishments are a wonder. There were no long legal agreements as we have today. William G. Kirchhoff's word was his bond. On November 8, 1913, right at the crest of the morning rush hour, a water main burst and flooded the boiler room at Redondo Beach Steam Plant. Over 1,000 streetcars became dead on the tracks. After 45 anxious minutes, the general manager of Pacific Light and Power Corporation decided to take a chance on their yet untried $12 million investment, which had consumed over 2 years of expended labor, and he ordered the switch to be turned on at Big Creek Powerhouse No. 1. This was a burst of 150,000 volts sent to the Eagle Rock substation. The trolley system rolled, and from that time until the 1950s, Big Creek was the major source of electricity for PL&P and its successor, Southern California Edison. This set another world record. Eagle Rock, which is right next to the history-making substation we just covered. Note the eagles on the rock. This is William Kirchhoff's venturesome history-making Pacific Light and Power Corporation's Eagle Rock substation, and is still in use today through Edison. This record-breaking success of 150,000 volts being transmitted over 243 miles also reflects back 21 years to another echo of a world record-setting event. This event took place on December 31, 1892, when Pomona College's first president, Dr. C. Baldwin, and A.W. Decker, a brilliant engineer, transmitted over 10,000 volts from the San Antonio Canyon to San Bernardino, an unheard-of distance of 29 miles. William A. Myers wrote in his book, Iron Men and Copper Wires, that the San Antonio Canyon plant established the commercial feasibility of long-distance transmission of electric power. This Big Creek campsite was located on the Stevenson Creek and was some time after Mr. Kirchhoff's tenure as president. This photo is just so unique on how they accommodated the workers in this remote location. Their task was to tunnel over to Powerhouse No. 3, just a most unusual scene. In 1917, Pacific Light and Power Corporation was consolidated into the Southern California Edison Company. The final amalgamation resulted in forming the fifth largest electric utility in the world. Further, Mr. Huntington became their largest stockholder and a director in the Southern California Edison Company. A further comment taken from William Myers' work entitled Iron Men and Copper Wires, between 1917 and 1929, plus the addition of the vast Big Creek project, the Edison became America's first large-scale progressive hydroelectric developer. In 1924, Eastwood was drowned while swimming in a mountain river, the King, which he so respected. He had lost his stock given to him for his outstanding work because of his inability to meet the stock assessments. His contribution to the Big Creek project was not forgotten by the Edison board. Mrs. Eastwood was given a lifelong provision, which stands as proof of the appreciation for his immense contribution. Order your copy by visiting the website www.citrusroots.com. Part 3 covers delivering natural gas to the area of Los Angeles for the first time. Los Angeles had no gas except for a small amount of manufactured gas, mainly for lighting. The source was from the Kern County oil fields. This was an immeasurable engineering task, especially over the nearly impassable Tehachapi Range. Southern California Gas Company and Midwest Gas Company met Kirchhoff's goal. Kirchhoff formed the San Joaquin Light and Power Company with the ambition of converting the San Joaquin area into a rich agricultural valley through the means of inexpensive electricity from his planned hydroelectric plants on the North Fork of the San Joaquin River, and supplementing the demand through steam-generated electrical plants. This would be accomplished through a network of transmission and distribution lines totaling about 6,000 miles of lines. From their first year to 1931, the gross earnings increased 100 times. Natural gas was dissipated into the air by the millions of cubic feet, for there was no use for it, a total loss. This was the driving force which compelled Mr. Kirchhoff to construct a pipeline through the steep Tehachapi Mountains. Los Angeles at this time was manufacturing a small supply of artificial gas. The properties were acquired and the Kirchhoff's Midway Gas Company was organized for the purpose of transporting the natural gas from the oil fields in the Taft area to Los Angeles, a distance of 120 miles. Also, in 1910, Southern California Gas Company had been formed as a public utility. The aforementioned were easy obstacles compared with the 120 miles separating one from success. The Tehachapi Mountains were miles of the most desolate, rugged, ridged range, which had been a natural barrier to California for centuries. This terrain had to be crossed, and it was at an exorbitant expense. The 453-foot-long tunnel represented a Herculean task of hard work, utilizing teams of horses and mules. Remember, up until the mid-1920s, motor vehicles were very limited by the degree of the grade. The gasoline from the fuel tank flowed by gravity and air pressure to the carburetor. On steep grades, the fuel tank would be lower than the carburetor, which explains why photos of vehicles were going in reverse on steep incline grades. All of the material extracted from the tunnel, the pipe, and equipment were hauled by the use of mules and horses. Note the pipes ready to be joined. The first delivery of gas was on April 28, 1913, a crowning victory. Or was it? So little was known of the reaction of natural gas to other materials. It was found that the gas, within a short period, had rotted the packing of all of the pipe joints. The lines had to be reconstructed. To put it in perspective, this was one of the longest pipelines in the U.S. at that time. After the pipeline construction was completed, the California highway known as the Ridge Route followed this same route through the tunnel. A vast, enormous change from Edward Beale's cut. Numerous oil fields were discovered in Los Angeles and Ventura counties, and a network of pipelines were delivering gas at about 210 million cubic feet per day. It has been said that this was more gas than was used by either the cities of New York or London. Mr. Kirchhoff succeeded through bond issues and loans. The fact that he never failed had to be a factor in addition to his known integrity and reliability in receiving funding. Projects that William Kirchhoff accomplished were so innocently and so honestly completed based on a man's word of honor. His word was his bond. Midway Gas Company and Southern California Gas Company were combined in 1928, and they served 201,700 consumers through 4,275 miles of pipelines. The value of these properties had increased from $860,000 in 1908 to about $60 million in January 1928. As Henry O'Melveny wrote, "The time was propitious, for Los Angeles without cheap fuel, factories could not exist." It was an example of his foresight. It is important to note that due to Mr. Kirchhoff's failing health, on November 1, 1927, Messrs. Kirchhoff, Balch, and Ben Myers, the three largest owners of stock in Southern California Gas Company and their associates, sold their stock holdings to Southern California Gas Corporation and realized a handsome profit. Mr. O'Melveny wrote of his friend and business associate, "Mr. Kirchhoff ended a continuous period of 36 years devoted to the public utilities of gas and electricity." Alan C. Balch joined Mr. Kirchhoff in 1898 and followed him through to the end. He was a very able right-hand man, and always presented an engineering balance to William Kirchhoff's enterprises. In 1902, William Kirchhoff and Alan C. Balch acquired Fresno Electric Light Company through a foreclosure sale. Abe Haas, Casper Cohn, and two other longtime associates of Mr. Kirchhoff also joined. The assets purchased were conveyed to a new entity, San Joaquin Power Company, which included this small hydroelectric powerhouse designated as Number 1. Later, a new, larger hydroelectric plant was built next to the original, and both were designated as Number 1. This early display of San Joaquin Light and Power Corporation facilities shows seven powerhouses, two dams, plus a steam plant in Bakersfield, and another at Midway. The San Joaquin River, starting at the summit, has a precipitous short drop to the floor of the canyon and debouches out into the valley in Kern County. This provides a unique opportunity to employ the same water numerous times in generating power. Further, the original course of the riverbed ran through forest reserves or unappropriated government lands, thus avoiding delays of settlements, adjustments, and litigation with private ownership. The physical situation was perfect for the development of hydroelectric power. San Joaquin Light and Power Corporation served about 6 million acres. They provided electricity to seven counties. The Midland County's Public Service Corporation received all of its power wholesale from the San Joaquin Light and Power Corporation. This public service corporation served Fresno, Monterey, San Luis Obispo, and Santa Barbara counties. The Kirchhoff Powerhouse was completed in 1920 as the 11th plant and was named in honor of the founder and president of the San Joaquin Light and Power Corporation. By 1924, they also had three steam plants and just under 6,000 miles of transmission and distribution lines. 15 months from the time ground was broken for the Kirchhoff Powerhouse, this great plant of 56,800 horsepower was delivering power to the San Joaquin system. The plant consisted of a concrete arch dam 570 feet long and 125 feet high, which diverted the water of the San Joaquin River through a tunnel cut through solid granite 3.5 miles to the powerhouse. San Joaquin Light and Power's landmark corporate office in Fresno was architecturally outstanding, and the interior was equally beautiful. The top floor was an auditorium, this Fresno skyscraper could be seen for miles, and at night it was brilliantly illuminated with 46 floodlights. The San Joaquin Valley witnessed a booming growth. In 1910, the company was recapitalized at $25 million. And in a little over a decade, the corporate capitalization was increased sixfold to $150 million. Much of the valley's growth was the result of the proactive effort of this corporation to provide electric power where needed. This increase in capitalization came from the outstanding fact which prevailed that Mr. Kirchhoff's word was his bond. Having never failed proved that he had this virtue. The men behind this growth: William G. Kirchhoff, President; Alan C. Balch, Vice President; A.G. Wishon, General Manager. Kirchhoff's San Joaquin Light and Power Corporation energized the vast San Joaquin Valley, plus Monterey and Santa Barbara counties, with inexpensive electric power generated from his company's hydroelectric plants on the North Fork of the San Joaquin River. Up until the buildup of the Lend-Lease programs regarding World War II, the citrus industry was California's second largest industry. Even by 1940, citrus was still within the top five of the state's largest industries. As we have traveled together through this video, and we have observed the progress of the sizing machine being driven by muscle strength through a foot treadle as an example of the era, to being powered by electricity. Now before us are photos of the 1930s, which show a photo of the interior of Johnston Fruit Company in Santa Barbara, an aerial of Strathmore Packing House, the exterior of Lindsay Citrus Growers Association. This was the largest citrus packer in Tulare County. Notice the electric transformers in the foreground. Delivering low-cost electricity to this immense area allowed for sizable growth. Now, remembering you're observing the high number of employees utilized in the packing of citrus, let us next visit the latest in technology, the ultimate in packing of California citrus, located in Kern County. Observe, very few employees. Longest in the world sizing and grading table, 310 feet long. The chain driving this Clementine sizing and grading table is 5 miles long. Electric power yields to the highest in modernity. Order your copy by visiting the website www.citrusroots.com. On the left side is an interior room of the Kirchhoff Mansion, now part of USC. On the right side is Kirchhoff Hertzforschungsinstitut, Bad Nauheim, Germany. In 1902, the Kirchhoffs hired the architect Myron Hunt to design their mountain house on the bank of the San Antonio Creek. Mr. Hunt later was commissioned to design the Huntington Library and Art Museum. The Kirchhoffs' mountain house had 10 rooms with the luxuries of a city home. The grounds also had two separate houses for the guests and a house for the family of the caretaker. On the opposite side of the stream bed was the garage, and the second floor provided living space for the chauffeur. In the front, on either side of the front steps, were pools fed by the diverted water of the stream. Each pool was stocked with trout, which the guests could select their own trout for breakfast. Behind his house is a large domed oven for the baking of bread, still there. The acreage has been spared from the frequent fires in the area. It is a beautiful setting with a large lawn in front, and the mature oaks and trees next to the creek. Above the house there is a flat parcel where Mr. Kirchhoff had an apple and pear orchard. As Mr. O'Melveny related, here the Kirchhoffs could disperse their lavish hospitality on their guests. On the bank of the creek, Mr. Kirchhoff would entertain by serving dinner next to the laughing mountain stream. Here he was happy, because he made his guests happy. The Kirchhoffs acquired their first house in the Los Angeles neighborhood on Main and 6th Streets, northeast corner. They had no children. In 1898, they adopted twin girls. It was mentioned by Henry O'Melveny that the daughters showered their father with great devotion and affection, and the grandchildren also gave him great joy. The Los Angeles Orphans Home, because of their assistance, was well supported by the Kirchhoffs, who were two of their largest contributors. We are on Main Street, looking at the north side of the Kirchhoff Building, circa 1915. The main tenant was the Santa Fe Railway Company, and you will also note the office of his lumber company occupying space. This Beaux-Arts-style commercial building was built on the site of their home at Main and 6th Streets. In 1916, Kirchhoff had the same firm, Morgan, Wall & Morgan, design an annex. In 1933, Santa Fe Railroad purchased the building and the annex, since they had been the anchor tenant. The Bank of California became insolvent and was liquidating a large parcel of land in Fresno County. The property came to the attention of Mr. Kirchhoff and Jacob Mansart because of the newly constructed Enterprise Canal from the Kings River. They purchased 3,027 acres and around 1910 named the development Kerman, derived from the first three letters of each of their last names. The canal added plenty of water, and the availability of electricity provided by Kirchhoff's SJ&LMP made the property a very desirable purchase. Kirchhoff left a footprint through the English Shakespearean and California craftsman architectural styles in Del Mar, plus various water developments throughout the northern San Diego County area. In the early 1900s, Kirchhoff joined ranks with Charles A. Canfield, Max Whittier, Burton E. Green, Henry Huntington, Moses Sherman, and a few others in forming the Rodeo Land and Water Company. This company went on to develop Beverly Hills under the direction of Burton E. Green. The photo is of the Beverly Hills Hotel in 1920, and note the Pacific Electric streetcar at the entrance of the hotel on Sunset Boulevard. William Kirchhoff had heart disease. On his deathbed, one of the last requests to his wife was to build that building Dr. Moore wants. A month before his death, Mr. and Mrs. Kirchhoff had visited with Provost Emmist Carol Moore on the young campus of UCLA. Dr. Moore had expressed a need for a student union. As Henry O. Melveny stated, quoting Emerson, "It, courage, is directness, the instant performing of that which he ought." His, Kirchhoff, whole temperament brought conviction to him that he ought to do these things, and therefore he did them. He had no fear of the outcome. As another example of his thinking, why not go up the San Gabriel River, bring down its water in a conduit, and thereby generate electric power? He did exactly that. Wealth came to Mr. Kirchhoff, but without a taint of wrong or suffering to his fellow men. One of William's last words to his wife was to carry out their intentions to provide funds for a student union at UCLA. Louise Kirchhoff very quietly ensured that his wishes were carried out, and the building honored his life. Mrs. Kirchhoff hired the architect and made certain the workmanship and material met her exact standards in erecting this Gothic building with its graceful archways and grand spires. Details of his life were embedded into the building. The stained glass images illustrated the hydroelectric dam. It was said that she visited the building site almost daily during the months of construction, and cost was not an issue. She chose every rug, every window treatment, every chair and desk, fully furnishing the facility by giving an additional $100,000, bringing the total gift to $815,000. This was the largest to date single donation to the university since its founding. Schonar left to right, Governor James Rolfe Jr., Mrs. Louise Kirchhoff, widow of William G. Kirchhoff, and Robert Gordon Sproul, president of the University of California. Governor Rolfe stated, "Mr. Kirchhoff was a man of vision, of kindly instincts, generous to a fault, and he never bore in mind that some part of his riches should be given for others to enjoy." Mrs. Kirchhoff affectionately said, "Students should have beautiful things around them." William Kirchhoff served as a trustee of the California Institute of Technology during the year of 1928. William Kirchhoff Marine Laboratory, California Institute of Technology, Corona Del Mar. One can clearly see the building from the Balboa Peninsula wedge area. After the dedication at UCLA, Mrs. Kirchhoff traveled to Germany to fulfill their other planned giving. Here she made a $4 million gift in honor of her husband by building this stately structure and endowing this institution. As Henry O. Melveny wrote, "Wherein the doctors could pursue their cardiac research and discover treatments which would bring recovery, comfort, and happiness to all humanity." For years, Mr. Kirchhoff was afflicted with heart disease and was a patient of Dr. Franz Grodel, an internationally known cardiologist and pioneer in cardiac radiology. Dr. Grodel fled to the U.S. before World War II and founded the American College of Cardiology. Kirchhoff Hospital in Bad Nauheim, Germany. This attractive new replacement was built in 2005. This 1909 grand mansion was their home. Louise Eshman Kirchhoff died in 1946, and the mansion was willed to USC in 1947. The home, USC Kirchhoff Hall, is now used as conference rooms and offices for the Annenberg Center of Communications. 734 West Adams Boulevard. The Kirkhoff Mansion. Note the decorative handcrafted plaster ceilings and outstanding woodwork. Kirkhoff Mausoleum at Forest Lawn, Glendale. The architect was Allison & Allison, the same as Mrs. Kirkhoff used for Kirkhoff Hall at UCLA. Mrs. Louise Kirkhoff's brothers, plus their families, were also included. Both brothers were officers of Kirkhoff Kuzner Lumber Company. The burials of the parents of Kirkhoff and Eshman were moved to be next to the mausoleum of William and Louise Kirkhoff. And so it comes about that after a lifetime of endeavor, and when success had been attained at last, he devoted the result of his success, with the loyal cooperation of Mrs. Kirkhoff, to the amelioration of mankind, that men and women may have happier lives. Kirkhoff Dome will stand forever. It perpetuates a name, but gives nothing. But the gifts to science and education build a monument, likewise eternal, through which he still lives, dispensing relief and help to countless generations of his fellow men. Order your copy by visiting the website www.citrusroots.com.